Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the OSPF underlay configuration for MPLS traffic engineering. I make an effort to break down complex telecom and networking technologies into easy to understand components. It's the way I wish I was taught when I was learning. If you find this approach useful, don't forget to like, subscribe, and turn on notifications so you'll get notified of my latest content. In the last few videos, we've been laying down the foundation for the understanding of MPLS traffic engineering. We've been reviewing the theory behind the technology to understand how it works. But enough theory. Let's get into practical configuration steps needed to deploy MPLS-TE. This is the topology we'll be using. Now, what has already been configured here? Well, the IP addressing scheme and the loopback addresses of all of our P and PE routers have all been assigned. Also, we have already enabled MPLS on all of the relevant interfaces, and we have configured regular OSPF and advertised all connected networks and loopback addresses so that all P and PE routers are aware of all of the routes on this topology. For MPLS-TE, we can either configure OSPF or ISIS as our underlay routing protocol. We'll be focusing on OSPF for this video. From here on, our configuration will involve the following steps. First, we'll enable MPLS traffic engineering support, both globally as well as on the relevant interfaces of the P and PE routers. Then we'll configure the OSPF underlay and enable the TE extensions of this routing protocol. We'll enable and configure RSVP-TE for our TE signaling. And finally, we'll create our TE tunnel interface. Let's get started. We'll start with the enabling of MPLS traffic engineering globally on our PE and P routers. Let's start with our PE1 router here. It's as simple as issuing the following command: MPLS traffic-ENG tunnels. You'll notice that enabling MPLS is usually the easy part. It's the rest of the protocols and mechanisms that can often become more complicated. Now, we do this on all of our P and PE routers like so. So MPLS-TE is enabled globally now on all P and PE routers. Next, we must enable MPLS-TE on the relevant interfaces. Now, these relevant interfaces are those that are participating in MPLS-TE. Typically for P routers, that's all interfaces. And for PE routers, that's all interfaces except those facing the customer equipment. To enable it on these interfaces, we issue the following command. It's actually the same command as the global configuration. Now we apply this command on all of the interfaces that you see marked in green here. Once all of that's done, MPLS-TE has been enabled and configured on the MPLS core network. Next, we'll enable OSPF traffic engineering as the underlay routing protocol for our topology. Remember, OSPF has already been enabled on these routers and the networks have been advertised. The only thing we need to do is to enable traffic engineering for OSPF, and we do it like so. Under the OSPF configuration mode, we issue the MPLS traffic-ENG area 0 command to enable it for area 0. And we also issue the MPLS traffic-ENG router ID loopback 0 command to indicate that we're using the IP address of our loopback 0 interface as the OSPF-TE router ID. Now, just like the regular OSPF router ID, the OSPF-TE router ID is used by the traffic engineering components of OSPF to identify this router uniquely. It's a different entity than the regular OSPF router ID, but it essentially serves the same purpose within the traffic engineering domain of the operation of OSPF. So within the traffic engineering database, or the TED, that's used by OSPF-TE, it is the OSPF-TE router ID that we will see. Now, these commands are issued on all OSPF routers within the network topology, and each one uses its loopback 0 interface IP address as the traffic engineering router ID. Next, we go on to configure RSVP-TE. RSVP must be configured on all of the interfaces that will be taking part in MPLS-TE. For our topology here, it is all these labeled interfaces on the PE and P routers. It's all those interfaces for which we enabled MPLS-TE as well. Let's see what commands we need to issue to configure this. We enter our interface configuration mode for Gigabit Ethernet 02 on our PE1 router, and we issue the IP RSVP bandwidth 500,000 command. Now the 500,000 number here is in kilobits per second. So essentially with this command, we're telling the router that any RSVP-TE signaling that traverses this interface must be informed that up to 500,000 kilobits per second will be allocated, or up to 500 megabits per second, which is essentially half of the throughput of our gigabit Ethernet interface. This command essentially tells the router the maximum amount of bandwidth that can be set aside for all of the RSVP requests that may pass through the interface. Every time a certain amount is allocated, it is subtracted from this maximum value. Now we issue this command on our Gigabit Ethernet 03 interface of the PE1 router as well. Now what about the rest of the routers? We must apply this command on all interfaces that may receive an RSVP signaling path. In other words, all the interfaces on all of our P routers, as well as the core-facing interfaces of our PE routers. Now finally, we come to the point where we can create our tunnel interface on our PE1 router. Because these LSP tunnels are unidirectional, we only need to configure the tunnel at the ingress label switching router, or ingress LSR. Here's how we do that. Initially, we create the tunnel interface and enter the tunnel interface configuration mode. Next, we issue an IP address. Now with this command here, what we're saying is that we don't want to assign a specific IP address to the tunnel, but it should adopt the IP address of the loopback 0 interface, which is 1.0.0.1/32. Next, we specify the type of tunnel we've created, which is an MPLS traffic engineering tunnel, or an LSP tunnel. We specify the tunnel destination, which is 2.0.0.2, which is our PE2 router. And this is reachable because OSPF has converged fully and we know how to get to that destination. Finally, we have a couple more commands that specify the characteristics of the tunnel. First of all, we specify the maximum bandwidth the tunnel will carry in kilobps. We've set that to 1000 kilobps or 1 megabps. The final command tells the router to use CSPF, or constrained shortest path, first as the algorithm to dynamically calculate the best path to the destination based on the underlying OSPF topology using the relevant TE constraints that we talked about in previous videos. And that's it. We've created our tunnel. What happens next? Now, I won't show you any verification commands yet, where you can check out the OSPF-TE information that has been exchanged, or the RSVP signaling, or the MPLS label switching. We'll check all that out in a future video. For now, I'd just like to show you this. Let's say we have our customer networks here on our CE routers. Let's take a look at our routing table of PE1. We see here that we have no routes. Once our MPLS traffic engineering tunnel is up and running, it won't be used automatically. It acts like any other physical interface, or like a GRE tunnel. You have to route traffic down your tunnel in order to use it. Now, there are several options we can use to do this. You can use static routing, use regular dynamic routing protocols, or even policy-based routing. But there are some other options that are more specific to MPLS-TE that offer enhanced flexibility, scalability, and integration. We'll talk about those in upcoming videos. For now, I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you have any questions or feedback, feel free to leave a comment below. I'm always happy to read the comments and to respond. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this video has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.